A'udhu billahi minash shaitani rajim. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. So we'll continue. And alhamdulillah, we have come to the second chapter. And it's the chapter on the seal of prophethood. This is a small fleshy mark that Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam bore on his back. It's sort of almost like a birthmark that is a sign given to him that he is the Prophet of Allah alayhi salatu wasalam. So again, I'm going to shorten the chain of narrators as it's quite long in the Arabic version, and just mention the name of the final or the closest narrator to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasalam. Hadithana Sa'ib ابن يزيد يقول ذهبت بخالتي إلى النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم فقالت يا رسول الله إن ابن أختي وجيء فمساح رأسي ودعا لي بالبركة وتوضأ وشربت من وضوعي وقمت خلف ظهري فنظرت إلى الخاتم بين كتفيه فإذا هو مثل زر الحجلة. Sa'ib ibn Yazid رضي الله عنه said, my maternal aunt took me to the Holy Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم and said to him, this nephew of mine is ill. Rasulullah alayhi salatu wasalam wiped his holy hand over my head and made for barakah for me. Yani, he put his hand on the child's head and prayed for him. Barakah means blessing. So Sa'ab ibn Yazid was a very small boy when this happened. So he would have been 8 or 9 years old. And so when the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam did this, he said, I saw the seal of prophethood, which was like the knot on a mosquito net or bedstead. So mosquito net doesn't make any sense. وَقُمْتُ خَلْفَ ظَهْرِهِ فَنَذَرْتُ إِلَى الْخَاتَمٍ بَيْنِ كَتِفَيْهِ فَإِذَا هُوَ مِثْلُ زِرِ الْحَجَلَةِ. Basically saying it was like a small knot. You know, you see a knot on wood, like a little protrusion on the surface of the skin. And I forgot to translate the part. وَدَعَا لِي بِالْبَرَكَةِ وَتَوَضَّعَ وَشَرِبْتُ مِنْ وَدُوعِ. So when the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam had taken wudu and he gave him the water of that wudu to drink as a cure. So this is this is one of the reasons we have the custom of drinking water that is blessed, and we believe in it that there is a cure. And of course, the water from the wudu, in which the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, the Messenger of God, his blessed hands attached, is considered blessed. So just by the touch of someone who is beloved to God, there is a blessing in that substance. So hadith number 16. I'll just read a bit of the chain. حدثنا أيوب بن جابر عن سماق بن حرب عن جابر بن سمورة قال رأيت الخاتم بين كتفيه رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم عدة حمراء مثل بائدة الحمامة. I saw the seal of prophethood of Rasul alayhi salatu wasalam between his two shoulders, which was like a red tumor, the size of which was like that of a pigeon's head. So if you can imagine, a pigeon's egg is around this size. So a small protrusion, really like a bump on the flesh. That's what he means here by a red tumor. Hadith number 17. حدثنا أبو مصعب المدني قال حدثنا يوسف بن ماجشون عن أبيه عن عاصم بن عمر بن قتادة عن جدته رميثة قالت سمعت رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم ولو أشاء أن أقبل الخاتم الذي بين كتفيه من كربه لفعلت يقول لسعد بن معاذ يا يوم مات اهتزله عرش الرحمن. لا. So Rumaytha رضي الله تعالى عنها said, I heard this subject from Rasulullah عليه الصلاة والسلام, and at that time I was so near him that if I wanted to, I could have kissed the seal of prophethood. That subject is Rasulullah عليه الصلاة والسلام was talking about Sa'ad ibn Mu'ad رضي الله تعالى عنه, that because of Sa'ad's death, the arsh, or the throne of Allah Azza wa Jal shook. So the context of this hadith is during the battle of Khandaq, when there was the trench dug around Medina, the third big battle the Muslims faced against the Quraysh, in this case the Hazab, the Confederates, all the Arabian tribes opposed to Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, had come together and they had surrounded the city of Medina outside the trench. And so there was a siege of Medina, and the Muslims had dug this trench from the advice of Salman al-Farisi, and they had to defend the trench from the Ahzab, from the Confederates, you know, jumping over. So it was not a passive siege, it was an active siege. So the Muslims would take turns to guard the Medinan side of the trench morning, noon and evening and night. And the Meccans would keep attacking and the Muslims would repulse, and so the standoff continued. So in one of those attacks, so they were, you know, they would attack with arrows mostly because they couldn't cross the trench. So in one of those, you know, this volley of arrows, an arrow pierced Sa'ad ibn Mu'ad's Sa'ad ibn Mu'ad, if you don't know, he was one of the young companions of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He was a young man, one of the leaders of Medina, said to be someone who would take on leadership in Medina, a prominent man from one of the tribes of Medina. Medina had two tribes, the Aus and the Khazraj, who were sort of at loggerheads with each other. And they realized that their feud between the tribes is going to destroy them and their city. And that's when they went and invited Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam to come over and take over the leadership of Yathrib. It was called Yathrib then, the city of Medina. So Sa'ad ibn Mu'ad was a young man who could have become a very prominent leader in the city and who could have fought to take over the city himself. But instead, when he heard the message of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he converted immediately. And not only did he convert, he came back to his tribe, his family, and he basically, through the force of his charisma and his personality and the courage of his conviction, he was the cause of a multitude of them to convert. And he lived his life basically for Islam, for the mission of Muhammad, as a great supporter of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. When the battle of Khandaq came, he was 36 years old, I believe. And it is said that when this arrow pierced him, he made this dua that, O Allah, if there are any more wars to be fought and I can defend Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, keep me alive. And if you will grant us victory after this and Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam will be safe, take me to you, because he had a fatal wound. And so they carried him to the nursing quarters. So the ladies, they would generally tend to the wounded. So the sahabiyat radiyallahu ta'ala anhunna, they were not idle watching their men fight. They were very much a part of that endeavor. They were generally nursing the sick. So they took him to the tent of Rumaitha, who was one of the prominent, you know, her tent was the tent, you know, the tent of healing. So they took him there and they tried to treat this wound. But by nighttime, they realized that he is dying and he doesn't have too much time left. So when they conveyed the message to Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he came running to the tent, and you can imagine all the prominent sahaba gathered around Sa'ad ibn Mu'ad as he is taking his last breath. And he mentioned that he made this dua, and when he was dying, he said, Ya Rasulullah, I am happy, because this means this is the last big battle the Muslims will have to face. And subhanallah, his dua was accepted, because Allah did take him back to himself. And after the battle of Khandaq, there were no more, you know, Fath Mecca came after that, the opening of Mecca came after that, the confederation was defeated of the Arab tribes who were against the Muslims, and after that there were only mild small skirmishes, but this was the last major battle in the history of the prophetic mission alayhi salatu wasalam. And it is said when he died and they went to bury him, his body was very, very light. There were many people to carry the body, that they couldn't feel anything. And after the burial, someone asked Rasulullah alayhi salatu wasalam, why is that? Why was his body so light? And he sallallahu alayhi wasalam said, you can't see it, but there were multitudes of angels who had come to attend his funeral and to carry him. So they were carrying the weight of the body, so therefore you didn't feel his weight. Radiallahu ta'ala an. And also, he was such a great sahaba, great disciple and follower and companion of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, a great supporter and helper, that it is said, Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, he said, because of the death of Sa'ad, the arsh, the throne of Allah shook. Subhanallah. And some commentators say that this is because Allah Azza wa Jal himself, subhanahu wa ta'ala, was so pleased and delighted with the life and effort and striving of Sa'ad that all the angelic realm, the heavenly realm, all the creation in realms other than what we can normally see and perceive were overjoyed that Sa'ad, is going to come back home and come back, what a victorious comeback for him. He has succeeded in great ways in fulfilling his mission on earth. So he was 36, I believe, when he died, Sa'd ibn Mu'ad. So this hadith is Rumaytha. She is talking about the seal of prophethood, which was on the back. So you can imagine this scene there in a tent, the tent where all the wounded are, all the Sahaba have gathered around Sa'd ibn Mu'ad, who is on his in his last, you know, in the pangs of death, really. And Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam is by his head, and they are waiting with him. And Rumaytha is just there, so she's just sitting at his head too. And she's so close to Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, she can see this, the seal on his back. And she says, I was so close to it, I could have kissed it. Subhanallah. So she is also an eyewitness to the seal of prophethood. And I think I should also point out from this hadith the way the Sahaba and the Sahabiyat radiallahu ta'ala anhum, the male and female companions of the Prophet around him, it was a very natural setting. They behaved with each other with dignity and respect and very naturally. So there was no false pretenses in their behavior with each other. They were extremely modest and extremely natural. So you can imagine this scene in a tent full of wounded, and the Sahabiyat tending to them, and the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam and the Sahaba coming. And it is also a reminder to us women that we should not be absent from the fields of battle, and in whatever way we are best suited to contribute, we should do that. And I don't mean battle in the literal sense of war. May Allah protect us from war. We should be struggling and striving to uphold the ideals and the message and the beauty and the truth of the Muhammadan way, which is what we are here to do. Alhamdulillah. So we should not leave it only to our brothers. We should also be there to help and to contribute in the best way we are suited to. Allah has given women special strengths that He has not given men. As He has given men special strengths, He has not given women. Of course, these are generalizations. There are women who are very good at manly things and men who are very good at womanly things. So everyone is unique. But in general, the message is that one should not, or we should not, absent ourselves from the metaphorically battlefield, from the fray. So, hadith number 18. حدثنا أحمد بن عبدة الضبيع وألي بن خجر وغير واحد قالوا حدثنا عيسى بن يونس عن عمر بن عبد الله مولى غفرة قال حدثني إبراهيم بن محمد من ولد علي بن أبي طالب قال كان علي إذا وصف رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم فذكر الحديث بطوله وقال بين كتفيه خاتم النبوة وهو خاتم النبيين. So Ibrahim ibn Muhammad, who is the grandson of Ali رضي الله تعالى عنه, so the son of Muhammad, who is the son of Ali كرم الله وجهه, said whenever Ali radiallahu ta'ala used to describe the noble attributes of Rasulullah alayhi salatu wasalam, he used to mention the complete hadith, the one we have talked about before. And he used to also say that the seal of prophethood was between his shoulders, because Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam was the seal of the prophets, the one who completed the prophethood. Hadith number 19. حدثني أبو زيد عمر ابن أخطب الأنصاري قال لي رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يا أبا زيد إذن مني فاسمح دحري فمسحت دحره فوقعت أصابي على الخاتم قلت وما خاتم قال شعرات Mujtami'at. Ilba ibn Ahmar al-Yashkari says that the Sahabi Abu Zayd Amr ibn Akhtab al-Ansari radiallahu anhu said to me, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam once asked me to massage his waist. It says waist, it means back. When I began massaging the back accidentally, my fingers touched the seal of prophethood. Ilba says, I asked Amr, what is the seal of prophethood? He said it was a collection of a few hairs. So you can imagine there was a small protrusion of flesh on which there, which had some hair growing on it, like a mole in a sense, right? Hadith number 20. حدثني عبد الله بن بريدة قال سمعت أبي بريدة يقول جاء سلمان الفارسي إلى رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم حين قدم المدينة بمائدة عليها رطب فوضعها بين يدي رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم فقال يا سلمان ما هذا؟ فقال صدقة عليك وعلى أصحابك فقال ارفعها فإنا لا نأكل الصدقة قال فرفعها فجاء الغدم بمثله فوضعه بين يدي رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم فقال ما هذا يا سلمان فقال هدية لك فقال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم الأصحابي ابسط ثم نظر إلى الخاتم على دهر رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم فآمن به فكان لليهود فأشتراه رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم بكذا وكذا درهما على أن يعرس لهم نخلا فيأمل سلمان فيه حتى تطعم فعرس رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم النخل إلى النخلة واحدة عرسها عمر فحملت النخل من عامها ولم تحمل نخلة فقال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم ما أشأن هذه نخلتي فقال عمر يا رسول الله أنا أرستها فنزعها رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم فأرسها فحملت من عامها So this is a beautiful hadith again. It's a long story that we'll read the English first. Buraida ibn Radiallahu anhu reports When Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam came to Medina, Salman Farisi radiallahu anhu brought a tray which had fresh dates on it and presented it to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, who asked to Salman, "What dates are these?" He replied, "This is sadaqa for you and your companions." Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam replied, "We do not eat sadaqa, remove it from me." On the next day this happened again. Salman radiallahu anhu brought a tray of fresh dates and he replied to the question of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He replied, "O Messenger of Allah, it is a present for you." Rasulullah alayhi salatu wa sallam said to the Sahaba, "Help yourselves." He then saw the seal of prophethood on the back of Sayyidina Rasulullah alayhi salatu wa sallam and embraced Islam. I'm going to stop here as I'm extremely tired, but we will continue later, inshallah. Namaste, Sayyidina Muhammadiya.